All right, hi. Let's talk about abs, okay? Now, this is a little bit of controversy in our industry, particularly in our market here in the Pacific Northwest. You have a population of students who are pretty interested in isotonic contractions in terms of, workouts, right? In terms of body shaping and conditioning. And while this isn't our central focus as yoga teachers, it is the central focus of the majority of our students. And we want to meet them where they are. We're not here to judge them or worry about them and their body image journey. Although we do worry about them and their body image journey, our main goal is to create the kinds of classes that they want to come back to. Okay? So, in the interest of customer service, you provide them what they're looking for, what they're requesting, what they want. I'm encouraging you to consider noticing what goes on before and after classes when people are on their mats. Some of them are taking time for themselves to meditate, to rest, to reflect, and that's wonderful. And some of them, get their ab workout in, and that's fine too. And notice what happens after class. Some of them are sticking around to meditate and reflect and rest. Some of them are doing their abs. I encourage you to notice what's going on in the actual class. In these groups, in these populations, in these communities, notice if the teacher is serving up crunches, yoga bicycles, Pilates scissors, side oblique crunches, any activity that are supine, working the rectus abdominis, your six-pack muscle, which takes and it originates at your sternum and it inserts in your pelvic bone, and this is the only muscle that can flex the spine from the supine position. So when you flatten your back and you bring your sternum closer to your pubic bone, that is an abdominal crunch. So you inhale to lengthen it out and you exhale to crunch and you work this muscle group. Similarly, side obliques, bring your rib to hip on each side. And when you talk to a lot of teachers about their choices in sequencing, you get a couple different schools of thought. There's a group that says, okay, this is yoga, not a workout. This is not fitness. So I'm not going to offer a set for abs because I'm teaching yoga here. And this is the third chakra where it's all about you and your ego, and we don't want to get that too rajasic and amplify one's sense of self-importance. I talk to teachers for a living, and there is a certain segment of them who feel it is beneath the practice and they do not deign to teach abs in their power yoga classes or their Hatha fusion classes. And I submit to you humbly with all the love in my heart that these are the same teachers that lead very popular and exciting arm balance and inversion workshops. And when you take these marquee master classes in arm balances and inversions, guess what they open with? These are the exercises you should be doing to strengthen your core. These are the things you should be doing every single day so that you can improve your arm balance and inversion practice. And all their sweet, adoring fans slash participants slash workshop attendees are secretly thinking under the breath, well, geez, if it was this important, why haven't you been featuring this in these classes I've been taking of yours for the last several years, two, three times a week, buddy? If it's so damn important to developing my arm balance and inversion practice, why haven't you been loading that into your sequencing? You can imagine how I feel about the idea that you would cultivate a base, a community, teach to them for years upon years and hold back your little secret sauce over here. Hold back your little secret stash of pro moves here while your practice is moving forward and showcasing it to the world, and everyone's like, ooh and ah, and wow, it's so fancy. And on the side, you're doing your own little regimen that you're only going to open up to your community when they're paying the big bucks for the workshops. So I'm just saying, it's a problem. All right, here's another opportunity that we can discuss. There are show muscles and go muscles, right? Show muscles are the ones that the students are looking to work on in terms of their six pack and their side obliques, and to a lesser extent, their erector spinae muscles of their lower back. And then there's the go muscles, the ones that we really need for strength on the inside, the transverse abdominis, the muscle that is the first layer over your viscera. It originates and inserts on an aponeurosis sheath of durable connective tissue called the thoracolumbar fascia. And it wraps around, again, it's the first layer of muscle over your organs. And it's like that girdle, that corset muscle. And it's what comes into the navel spine connection in Uddiyana Bandha. And when you cough or laugh or go ch, 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 ch in Kapalabhati breathing. This muscle is most often activated doing prone activities like forearm plank, like knee to elbow repeaters in forearm plank and in plank. And it's these activities, doing the planks and all of the variations upon them, that get at the transverse abdominis. Again, this isn't isolating and emphasizing the six-pack and side oblique muscles. Those are the show muscles. They live on the outside. So it goes skin, six-pack, obliques, transverse abdominis, organs, spine. And so go muscles, the ones we need for strength, that is your transverse abdominis that live on top of the viscera, the organs, underneath the show muscles. Now, let's also talk about where you would put these activities in. If you're a teacher who will not deign to do repeaters and crunches because you feel like that's aerobics, that's fitness, I don't want to do that in my class, and you prioritize the go muscle activities in terms of your planks, your forearm planks, to emphasize your transverse abdominis muscles, which are the single most important group of muscles other than your psoas major, which is also part of your core when you get technical about it, in doing your arm balances and inversions and keeping your spine healthy. A lot of teachers, they'll use the plank stuff, and we have an opportunity to talk about when is that stuff most effective. I submit to you humbly that where we're doing quadruped in the section one, you could also instead do planks, forearm planks, and do the knee elbow repeaters and the variations on there to address transverse abdominis, to help wake up and recruit this muscle group. I don't agree with putting plank-based transverse abdominis go muscle activities in the 40-minute section. People are already very tired in their wrists. And once we are past the tree pose, once we are past the 40-minute mark, we are past the opportunity to do anything related to plank or downward facing dog. Once the 40-minute mark has been passed, you're on the floor for the whole rest of class. No one wants to be on their wrists. So I submit to you humbly, with all the love in my heart, that's where you would want to put in your isotonic contraction exercises, is after the tree, after the balancing sequence, when you're on the floor, as kind of like the doorway to the floor sequence. Okay? So you could also put abs and repeaters in section one in integration. A lot of students will request this at the desk. When you say, hi, welcome to class, I'm so glad you came. How are you feeling head to toe? And what would you like to work on? A lot of them will say to you, oh yeah, I'm glad you asked. Can we do abs at the beginning? Because I don't like doing them when I'm tired. Well, then that's an opportunity. Yeah, you could put it in at the beginning of class. Just have your game plan prepared for how you will get them from being supine, belly up, to prone, belly down. Because you're going to want them in child's pose and downward facing dog to get on the road for your sun salutations. So how are you going to get them from being on their backs to being on their tummies elegantly without, okay, there's enough abs, everybody downward facing dog, right? We don't roll like that. We want to connect pose to pose to pose. So we'll look at that sequencing option. I submit to you that you probably should still put it in at the 40-minute mark. And when people are surprised by this or they fight you on this saying, well, I'm tired by that point, well, I want you to take a look at just good exercise physiology in general. As a personal trainer, it's always been my goal throughout my career to train you properly. And what we would always do in a regimen when it came to the heavy weights is we would work your biggest muscle groups first and then work your smaller muscle groups last. And we need your core for that whole enterprise so we wouldn't blow out your structural muscles on the front end. Does that make sense? I'm not going to put you in your warm-up before your big heavy weight training activities in a whole bunch of plank and a whole bunch of forearm plank and a whole bunch of core, because we need these muscles to keep you safe doing your squats, doing your deadlifts, doing your lunges properly, doing your chest presses, especially if we plan to use any sort of stability equipment like the Bosu ball or the Fit ball, you know? So again, just good exercise programming says, buddy, you're going to need your core for the whole class to stay safe in these poses. How about we don't get them super fatigued in the first 10 minutes? Does that resonate? No one's going to die, but I'm just saying for my money, my priorities are always going to be, let's wake up the go muscles in the section one when your wrists are still fresh and you feel like dealing with plank and forearm plank a whole bunch. Let's do the ab contractions and all of the repeaters at the 40-minute mark, where we don't need to be standing and keeping your navel spine connection, protecting your spine. We're on the floor for the rest. So we might as well blow out your abs there because we're not standing up again until we're done. So that's my thinking behind it. I'm not opposed to sprinkling abs in all throughout the class too. We will talk about sneaky ways that you can put in the go muscles and the show muscles all throughout the sequence. Just as a little preview to that, think about it. Inhale, lift your right leg high. Exhale, half scorpion. Bend your knee, roll up on your hip, choose to stay or flip your dog. Flip dogs, foot finds the floor, all 10 toes spin to the back of the room, press your heels, lift your hips. Everyone sit down. And then that's when your ab track's going, just as a surprise in section six. How would we get them back? Go back to flip dog. Press your feet, lift your hips, having a hand in the air. Change, spy the mat, flip it back. Inhale, three-legged dog. So that's a fun place. And any place where you're flowing, chaturanga, hold, put your elbows down, forearm plank, toe taps, tap to the left, tap to the right. And then you got them right back up plank, chaturanga, flow it through. See? So there's ways that you can sneak them in all throughout the class. Because again, this is the kind of teacher you are. You don't cook it all up at home and then serve it to the people. Be like, here's the class I created today. That's not how we roll. We ask the check-in questions at the desk. We say, how are you feeling head to toe? What do you want to work on today? And you guys, after a lifetime of doing this professionally, I'm here to tell you that 90% of the time they're going to say abs. Really, it depends on the community. It depends on the season, but there's that. Now, let's address another point that I know you may or not be thinking, but is another reason why teachers fight students on abs in terms of showcasing this in yoga, is that you can work your six pack and your side obliques all day long, but if your nutrition isn't in alignment with your body composition goals, you're not going to see any improvement. So there is also the maxim, abs are cooked in the kitchen, right? Yeah. But I'm not going to bum my students out. It's beyond our scope of practice as yoga teachers to start dealing with macronutrients and prescribing nutrition strategies. That's not our job. And it's not appropriate as yoga teachers anyway. We're here to celebrate the body you're in today without the agenda of trying to change it or fix it or improve it. We're trying to liberate you from suffering. But again, in the interest of customer service, we want to meet them where they are. So we want to serve up the abs because that's what they're requesting. So I get why teachers don't do it, but I'm surprised more teachers aren't meeting their students where they are doing it. So that's why we're working on this today. So hopefully that helps you understand where we're coming from. Okay. All right. Now let's break it down. The goal here of this activity is to work on choreography. Part of performance element in teaching an effective yoga class has to do with little things like musical interpretation. You know, just like your lighting, you know, when you turn your lights up or down, on or off in class, and stagecraft, you know, blocking. Where is your body? Are you demoing a pose? Are you walking around? What are you doing in the moment? Are you adjusting? Are you demonstrating? The abdominal set is one in which you do best doing it with them on the floor, rocking it out. So a couple of reasons for this. First of all, when you stop, they'll stop. So if you walk around, like, they're not going to be as into it as if you were on the floor duking it out with them. I feel bad thinking about a teacher walking around just cueing the moves without doing it with them for so many reasons. And I get that you want to see what everyone's doing. I mean, it's not the 80s where fitness centers really did have mirrors on the ceiling and you really could see every row in the room because you were on your backs over there and you were looking up. That was awesome. But I'm just encouraging you to consider how much more fun it is that way when you're doing it with them. You're like, but I'm going to get tired. How am I going to talk and rock at the same time? Trust me, that's part of what fight or flight does for you. The anticipatory response to not just fitness, but teaching a class is that adrenaline boost during which you will be able to throw down with your class and you don't get tired. You don't feel fatigue. You don't feel heat. You don't feel any sort of illness or hunger or hangover or whatever you have going on. It's the best part of teaching is that fight or flight, that norepinephrine, epinephrine, the catecholamines, all these stress hormones, the cortisol gets in there and it gets you sharp and it helps you show up. It's part of what the upside of Mother Nature giving you stress hormones does for you. So capitalize upon that to have fun teaching. You're also going to get in the best shape of your life because you won't believe what you can get done while you are holding space for other people. The hardest thing in the world is to take someone's ab class, and the easiest thing in the world is to teach and take your own ab class, I have found. So I'm excited for you to experience that. All right, so let's take a look at the basic moves that we will mix and match. And then we'll take a look at great songs we can use and their structure. And then we'll take a look at how we choreograph the basic ab moves and we utilize the structure inherent in the songs, okay? All right, so let's address show muscles, basic crunch, right? Now, we're all familiar with this, but these form cues are gonna be very important in your teaching because you want people to do this properly to get the most out of it. So let's begin. When you go to do a basic crunch, obviously you want your feet flat on the floor. And obviously what you want is your lower lumbar curve completely pressed flat to the floor. All right, so everybody right now, if you could on your mat, please put your feet flat and place your hands in your lumbar curve. Like, you're not using any core muscles right here or anything. You're just noticing that without trying, there's a gap between your spine and the mat, okay? That's what your hands are filling up right now. So next step in this activity, please put your thumbs on your lowest rib and your pinkies on your hip markers and tuck your tailbone under, thus flattening out your lumbar curve. So again, before, there's a thumb, there's the pinky to your hip marker, the ASIS bone. And then after, you're gonna pull your pelvic floor up and in, doing Mula Bandha, and you're essentially pressing very flat your lumbar curve. There should be no space under your lumbar curve here. Now, the idea about isolating your rectus abdominis is to take the origin where it inserts, it attaches right there to your sternum, and this six-pack muscle then inserts into your pubic bone. And when you bring the origin closer to the insertion, that's the definition of muscle contraction. You are now flexing your spine using the only muscle that can flex the spine from the supine position, which is rectus abdominis, the six-pack, we call it, okay? Now, you want to keep your chin off your chest, because if you tuck your chin in, you're just going to overly fatigue your neck. And you're also going to jip yourself out of more of the load on this muscle. So tuck your chin in and see how you can crunch up and down, lift your chin, tuck your pelvis, lift your heart, your ribs, right to the shoulder blade tips. If you have your chin away from your chest, it's just a little more load on the rectus abdominis, which is what we're after, and a little less stress on your neck, okay? The next thing I want to talk about is hands. Now, we want to mostly take the first two fingers and touch just behind your ears, okay? I am not interested in anybody interlacing their fingers, and I'll tell you why. They tend to press on their head, they tend to strain their neck, and they tend to just end up kind of head bobbing instead of doing the activity. But if your first two fingers are gently touching the back of your head, your skull, behind your ears, take a breath, come in, come down, and on your exhale, come up, and do a few of these on your own. Tuck your tail. Feel how Mula Bandha kicks in just automatically. As you inhale and come down, there's your lumbar curve getting lifted. So let's pull your pelvic floor up and in, Mula Bandha. And now let's push your navel to spine, flattening your low back, Uddiyana Bandha. And we'll keep your neck and chin in alignment. So kind of emphasizing Jalandhara Bandha also. So, you know, you're understanding that this is the way that you protect the spine. And it's also the way that you fortify the core muscles we're talking about. So there you are, holding very gently, gently, your first two fingers behind your skull. You know, you could spread out the fingers, use all the fingers. Just keep a very light touch, because what you're trying to do is just keep your chin off of your chest. Now, students sometimes will tell you that when they do basic crunches, they have neck pain. So I have a trick. We can offer them the idea of holding a little towel behind their head. So let's find a prop here. Taking an item like a yoga strap or a little towel, optimally, you would put it right there so that it kind of creates a hammock for the skull, for the head. And this is where you would want them to position it. Right there at the very roundest part of your skull. And you would have them hold here, and thus holding their prop with nice straight wrists. And this will keep their chin where you want it. So as they come down to do a crunch, they're going to keep the hands just like this so they can rest their head back. Now, if you've got a scarf handy or a towel or a strap handy right now, guys, take advantage of this. As you breathe in, you come down. As you exhale, you come up. And this honestly feels pretty good. It doesn't knock a thing off your neck. And kind of feels like that. Remember that device in the 90s, the abdoer? People paid all this money for this contraption that they would rest their head on and hold the handles and rock it. So you're kind of just invented the abdoer here with your favorite fashion accessory, a scarf or a kimono. Yeah. All right. So there we are. We're getting some good form going here. The basic crunch. So while you're teaching, you are emphasizing flatten your back, right? Tuck your tailbone under, right? Keep your chin off your chest, right? Exhale to execute, right? Keep your back flat. So this is a lot of what you're saying during this set, because you're not counting your every single rep. That's boring. You're only counting the last four or so in a set. So you're loaded up, and all along, you're emphasizing the breath being a ch, 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 T-S-C-H. So you tell your students, all right, breathe out like you're saying T-S-C-H. It's basically Kapalabhati breathing, isn't it? Because when we're in Hatha class in the Bikram tradition, and we end up doing the ch, ch, yeah, you're getting transverse abdominis, and to a lesser extent, you're getting six pack. But that same burst of ch, ch, ch is what we're doing when we do the isotonic contractions of abdominals. I should back up and qualify isotonic and isometric. When you're holding a posture, you're using an isometric contraction of the muscles involved. This means that all the muscles are lit up, firing, and contracted, but there's no movement at the joint. That's the definition of isometric. Isotonic is when you're using repeaters of lifting and lowering, flexing, extending, you know, whatever the joint action is, there's movement at the joint while the muscles are contracting, and they take turns doing the eccentric and concentric phase. And all this is in book one, first 20 pages of your anatomy book. Don't let the lingo drive you nuts. So when you hear isotonic, I always remembered it like tone, like to tone a muscle, you do isotonics. So anyhow, that's your basic crunch. Keep it basically simple, chin off your chest, back flat, so that you don't have that ricocheting. Now, have you ever been in that moment where maybe you had on like no shirt, or women, just the jog bra, and that your skin was exposed to your mat? And have you ever been in that kind of class where maybe your towel slipped away from your mat, and maybe you've been in that kind of class where you were really sweaty? If you were doing your abs wrong, every time you came up, your lumbar curve would go back into its nice convex shape. So every time you came up, it was a sound, right? Inhale, like your back smashing into the mat that's wet. You know, it was not only embarrassing for you and your neighbors, but it's also telling you, hey, you're using momentum, okay? Any clown can keep the convex curve of their lumbar and just, that's not a crunch. There's no load, really. I mean, there's a little load, but you're just kind of undulating. Let's instead maximize the opportunity, because at that point, in a really good contraction where your back is flat, your chin's off your chest, and you're only bringing the origin at the sternum closer to the insertion at the pubic bone, your head becomes a medicine ball at that point, right? Human head weighs 8 to 10 pounds, depending how much is on your mind. When you use your fingers to gently hold the skull, it's like you're wielding a nice medicine ball to the exercise. So that's a high quality basic crunch, okay? We're just coming up to the shoulder blade tips, okay? Now I know in the Bikram style transitional sit up, the breathing's different and the movement's different. Let's just contrast, take a look at that. Loop your thumbs, flex your toes, inhale to sit up. Double exhale to touch your feet. Some of the times we get confused. We're like, well, we're inhaling to come up on that one. How come on this basic crunch you are saying exhale to come up? Well, I'm glad you asked, if you did. We are exhaling to execute because this is a closed chain activity. That means there's nothing flying around in space here. It is all about bringing the contraction of the muscle into play while we execute, just like we would do if we were doing bicep curls or push-ups. Think about it. Yeah, you're going up on a push-up, but you're not inhaling because you're going up and exhaling as you come down. Try that. That's an impossible push-up. It's stupid. And some yoga teachers get that wrong because they're like, well, we're going up, so we should be breathing in. No, it's closed chain. Your hands are pushing off against something. So in an effort to reduce intrathoracic blood pressure, you exhale to execute because you're pushing away the floor. Okay. Same thing with your basic crunch. You're going and it's a closed chain. Your feet are down. Your back is flat. And yeah, stuff's lifting, but the muscle that's contracting against the forces of gravity, drawing the origin closer to the insertion, is working in such a way that you need to inhale to recruit and exhale to execute. However, the transitional sit-up that we don't really use in power, it's open chain. See how my hands are in space? My legs are in space? And I'm really just reaching up like it's an upward salute, like it's Urdhva Hastasana, like it's an inhale and it's a big old backbend idea. Why two exhales? The first exhale knocks on the door. The second exhale opens and goes through the door. It's just like you get starting on the breathing out and then you breathe out more to touch the toes. But anyway, this is power yoga discussion, not Hatha. So let's keep going with more basic moves. All right, let's go side obliques. Now, the side oblique muscle group, they originate at your ribs and they attach to the upper part of your hip bone, the iliac. And so their job is to help to flex the spine laterally. So their job is to bring rib to hip. That's how you recruit these muscles. You recruit them by bringing the origin closer to the insertion. Origins are always closer to the core and the trunk and the top of the body. Insertions are always distal and farther away from origin. So hip bone, rib, we bring them closer. That's the contraction. The inhalation is the lengthening phase. The exhale is the execution phase. Now, in a side oblique, you start from the same basic crunch position, and then you drop your knees to one side. Now, your knees are off to one side, and you take your fingers and you place them behind your head. You keep your chin off your chest as ever, and your job is to bring the origin at the rib closer to the insertion at the hip bone. Now, you can get this job done best by looking at the ceiling. That will enable you to keep your chin off your chest. And with your fingertips gently behind your ears, your goal is to keep looking up the ceiling as you bring rib to hip. Rib to hip, that's the move. Now you can add a little bit more challenge by lifting your top leg, but let's be clear, this is not a leg lift activity. I'm not trying to isolate the abductors and the gluteus medius complex on this side of my hip. No, the leg isn't lifting for that muscle to work. The leg is lifting to help me bring in and hold this little pinching idea of rib to hip. So here's my fingers behind my head. Here's my chin off of my chest. And here's my top leg lifting only incidentally to bring in this tighter squeeze of rib to hip. You must keep your eyes up on the ceiling. You must keep your chin off your chest. And as ever, this very light fingertip pressure holding the back of your skull. So as you breathe out, there you go. Rib to hip. Rib to hip. And you exhale to execute. All right, that side's getting tired, so let's switch sides. You come in through the center and make it true. Your feet are together, your knees are together, you're just dropping your knees over, okay? So in this starting phase, you do kind of want to be in a fetal position. You do kind of want to be exactly on your side. But it turns into the side oblique recruitment activity when you lay your shoulders down as able, you put your fingers behind your head as before, and you lift your top half toward your ceiling, and you keep looking up. And again, so try a few here with your legs stacked and see how, yeah, that's doing the job. Put your fingers there and feel it. Feel it. I really always ever taught this activity in my life as a trainer by having people really dig their fingers in between, because you can feel the delineation of side oblique and six pack. Oh, and I'd like to finish my thought from before if I could right now. Yeah, abs are cooked in the kitchen. And dude, when we did cadaver review in personal training school, we really learned that everybody has a six pack. I mean, we saw cadavers from little old people, very large people of size, people who were well, people who were ill, and everyone has a six pack, right? It's just a matter of nutrition, if you can see them or not. And again, we're not here to tell people there's something to fix about their body or change about their physical form. We're just loading this up because people want it. And frankly, they're paying big bucks and taking time out of their day to come to our class. I feel blue when I see students bust out a bunch of crunches before and after class because their teacher wasn't meeting their needs, period. So thanks for listening. So here we are. We're going to lift the leg now. Now lift your leg and see, yeah, if you get a little deeper of sensation. You're a few reps in here, so go to your good form. Fingers behind your ears, chin away from your chest. Lift your top leg and then squeeze rib to hip, rib to hip, hip to hip, rocking through the wilderness. Yeah, I can't wait to add music to this. This is a good time. And side obliques, man. This, I love this muscle group. You know, as a trainer, I always emphasize side obliques a crazy ton because it's a quick builder. You really do see this thing build. And then, you know, I don't know. It's a good feeling to have that tight little hug sensation. So it's a good time. All right, guys, let's keep going. You know what I just remembered? This is funny. Okay, let's go for a couple more reps. There is a video from 1993 called 8 Minute Abs. And I want you guys for a homework assignment to Google. I think you can find it in our YouTube channel. I think I posted it because I love it so much. My daughter, when she was a freshman and she was preparing for tryouts for cheer, she used the 8 Minute Abs thing like 2 times a day. That kid got shredded. It's a good video. And it's really cheesy and cute. The instructor's adorable. I hate that he says some of those classic stereotype things. So I want you to listen for the video and find out the dialogue we won't be using in yoga. But anyway, it's a good time. And it's only 8 minutes. And I think it would give you good ideas for your repertoire as you are sequencing and choreographing abs. So let's write that down as a homework assignment that you will watch 1993's Finest. 8 Minute Abs. I think it's filmed like in Florida. He looks like he's in the Everglades rocking it with his buddies in the leotards. Okay, back to basics. We just talked about executing excellent side oblique crunches. We talked about the six pack, doing basic crunches. Now let's look at yoga bicycles, okay? Yoga bicycles are fun because they do both of these muscle groups. You get a little bit of your six pack, you get a little bit of your side obliques, and we begin with your knees at 90 degrees. Now, for quality execution here, friends, have your students start with putting their hands on their knees, then pushing their knees away. When you have your hands pushing your knees away, you're going to get the optimal angle here. You want 90 degrees from your core to your thigh bone. Notice how easy bicycles feel when you do them with your knees closer. So again, like, like really close knees. Yeah, that's one way. But if you put your hands and push away your knees, the extension of your arms, and start your 90 degree there, then, oh, that's a little harder. Okay, it's just hip flexion to bring your knee closer to your core, but the long stretch and then bringing it in helps to reinforce this tailbone tuck under idea of keeping your lumbar flat, okay? As ever, you want your chin off your chest and you alternate touching your elbow knee, you exhale to execute. Now, keep going as you're practicing here. And notice if it's different for you to kick with your heel, like you're kicking out the wall, or pointing your toe. See what changes internally with the activity. I really do think both are best, but I'm always surprised about different sensations going from when I have the foot flex or the toe pointed. Okay? So yoga bicycles. Exhale to execute. And here's where we're going with all this TSCH. Ch-ch-ch. We want to follow the beat. So we want the music to be going as well. So when we choose songs, we're going to help our students achieve great results with the proper timing. Time under tension, we call that in fitness. The overload principle that you would be putting on your muscle, this application of effort, the tapas, if you will, right? The hard work, such that it's properly timed. A 2 count inhale, exhale is good for your any isotonic contractions. So it's not ch 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 ch, it's ch ch ch, so that it's a 1 2 1 2. That's the same you would do for bicep curls. 1 2 1 2. 1 2. It's like a 2 count. So when we work on choreography, we're going to listen for songs that are around 100 to 120 beats a minute, not a whole lot faster than that. Okay, so bicycles. Now, what's a variation on bicycles we could also offer is Pilates scissors. So you would extend your top leg straight and you would extend your bottom leg straight. You would bring your elbows towards your shin, keep your chin off your chest, breathe in here, and as you exhale, switch. Breathe in here, as you exhale, switch. So this applies the principle of alignment that we talk about, change leverage is necessary. See, this is a longer lever, having your legs be straight, and that puts a little more load on the core, doesn't it? This is a lot more challenging than if, okay, so elbow knee is even more. So let's go elbow knee with straight legs. Notice the leverage adjustment there. This is harder than. So we call it Pilates scissors. take your hands behind your right calf. Let your left leg go straight down, but don't drop your leg to the floor. Similarly, keep your chin off your chest and remain touching just your shoulder blades down, okay? So as you're switching, you're keeping full recruitment on the six pack. Does that make sense? You're putting a little extra load on the lower abdominals. Now, it's the same muscle as the rectus abdominis, the lower abdominals, but they're separately innervated. So they're gonna feel a little bit different than when you're working the six pack, but trust me, it is the same muscle group. So it's the same muscle that's responsible for flexing the spine from the supine position, and we're just putting more load on it by straightening out the legs. And then here's the ultimate load, is when you take an elbow to a knee, alternating like that. All right. So let's talk about another activity that we mix into the fun. Climb the rope. Now when climb the rope, you exhale to execute, and you want to keep one shoulder blade on the floor each rep. So touch your right foot and notice it is your right shoulder blade on the floor. Touch your left foot and notice it's your left shoulder blade on the floor. Take a breath. Take a breath. If you want more. 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 If you want less. If you want less. So those are some great things to alternate. Basic crunch, side oblique, bicycle, Pilates scissors, Pilates scissor bicycle where it's elbow knee there. And I would encourage you to also add climb the rope. Those are great. Here's another couple ideas. With your feet together and your knees apart and your lumbar curve flattened down, fingers behind your ears can be a nice new way to crunch. And it's just a little bit different when you lift your feet. Okay, so it's hard to isolate the lower abdominal region just doing basic crunch. So this is where the reclined butterfly, reclined cobbler, Supta Baddha Konasana crunches are fun. And for more challenge to your lower abdominals, you would lift your feet. So that's an idea. Okay. Now from here, we can also demonstrate more about changing the leverage as necessary. If you cross your arms and do a crunch like this, that's a little bit easier than if you have your fingers behind your ears. Similarly, having straight arms is way more load. I don't really endorse that one because it's very hard to help your neck stay neutral on that one. But let's be clear, if you were working with your trainer, you would hold a medicine ball here and you would throw it and catch it and throw it and catch it in various different ways. And this could be one of them. Or just holding it. Even just a fit ball here, right? And you're like, how could something full of air suddenly weigh 600 pounds? It's because you've changed the leverage. You've brought your arms, the lever, farther away from the fulcrum, the working muscle site, which is your six pack, okay? So now we also have some fun with taking Kali Mudra. So when you interlace your fingers, release your pointer across your thumbs, and it's kind of like a pew pew, like a little laser pointer gun thing. That's another way we can crunch. And then this is another way we can go to the right, to the left. I always feel like a cop in this one. Freeze their back. Let's leave gun violence out of yoga. I'm just being silly. So here's the idea. You are kind of rolling to one shoulder blade. Your arms are pointing, so that's a good time. You could do this with your legs too, obviously. If your legs are straight, you can crunch and point with Kali Mudra this way. But again, it's kind of hard to hold the neck. Here's your straddle legs. You could take it to the right, take it to the left. That's kind of fun, just alternating between shoulder blades. All right, let's look at a final thing that you would add to the mix in concert with your musical interpretation, the 30-60-90. Everyone, take your hands and place them underneath your hips, because this, of course, does what? It makes your lumbar curve flat. It puts you into the pelvic tuck that you need, right? Now lower your legs about 30 degrees. You remember the lecture about Mula Bandha here, so keep going. Pull your pelvic floor up and in, and your Uddiyana Bandha to keep your back flat. Now, once you get to about 60 degrees, that's where you need to come up to your elbows, okay? And if you like, you can scissor your legs. You can go even lower, but again, you got to be on your elbows here. You can't have a flat back and have your legs below 60 degrees. That will hurt your lumbar curve. That will very much damage L5-S1. And so we won't have it, you know? And as more fatigue sets in, it's just that much more important to be safe. So having them propped to their elbows when you're anywhere below 60 degree angle, hello Guinness, are you joining in the fun? You can also tap your heels together like Charlie Chaplin feet. You can swim or flutter. It's all gonna be based on your musical interpretation, okay? You can lift and lower your legs in time with the music. We could do lower abdominal lifts too. That's fun. And just point your toes straight up on the exhale. Shh. You could add a basic crunch with the hip lift, right? So many choices. And it's just going to be dictated by your musical interpretation. So I think it's a good time for us to look at some songs, shall we? All right. Okay, before that, let's just do our due diligence. We just worked the show muscle. Let's look at our go muscle activities just for review. Again, forearm plank stuff, your feet are together, you could kick, you step your toes out. So say your music, boop, 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 or your knee elbow, and that's with straight arms or elbows down, as you know. Again, for go muscle work. Where would you put that? Hopefully section one as an accompaniment or as an alternative to your quadruped. Quadruped, I would argue, kind of combines show muscles and go muscles, but you would never put that stuff in at the 40-minute mark because why? The wrists are tired. Let's blow out the six-pack instead at the 40-minute mark. Okay, so go muscles, that's the plank stuff. Show muscles, that's the contractions that we just did. Music, all right. You want to make sure your song is around 4 minutes. 3 minutes is fine. 4 minutes is great. I love using 6 minute songs, but I usually save that for a yoga sculpt where they know going in that it's gonna be a lot of work. I mean, when we get to the yoga sculpt lecture next week, we talk about, hey, guess how many minutes of abs we do in yoga sculpt? 15. Yeah, there's a whole quarter of an hour devoted to it. So, but I've learned the hard way in normal general population power classes that 4 is the sweet spot. I'm giggling because I'm thinking about how Heroes by David Bowie is a great song. It's great to sing to. It's great to listen to. It's one of my favorite karaoke go-to songs, but it's 6 minutes and people are just over it. You know, it has a great steady beat for abs, but I've always felt a little bit bad past the 4 minute mark. So let's look at the 4 minute choices that we love. Earlier today, we were playing with the song called Move by Saint Hotel. And this lecture is going to be not just about, hey, let's pick a song, but hey, let's learn a song, right? We want to map a song. We want to map the song. And when you map a song, you can then choreograph the activities that go with it. So what we're hearing right now is the intro, right? The clapping part. So when you pull out a piece of paper and you go to map your song, we're going to label this A for those little claps, B for the beats that we're on right now. And do you see how this is the same stuff? Now listen, change. This is C. He's talking, so we know that's the first verse. He runs this 2 times. Okay, now here's the third round, but it's different. It's different. It's different. It's a wind up. We're going to label this a D thing, all right? Kind of a little hold, and then what? Drop it. Here's the chorus. Move. Move. So we're going to label that E. Na 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 na. Boy, this is a fun one, right? Because people can sing to it. Move. Right? Na 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 na. Now listen. What does this sound like? Sounds like C. This is the second verse. He's running it twice. See? Running it twice. Right? So now what's next? Do you hear it? Yes, you hear it. What was that? That little transition period. That little transition period. Before what? Before what? Before what? E. The chorus. Move. 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 Na 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 na. Ooh. Another round. Woo. Move. Move. Na 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 na. Now what happens next? Ooh. We call this the bridge. It's totally different. You could use it for a break. We're gonna label this part F. What now? It's kind of like the chorus, but there's no of the singy part. So let's call that G. We'll call it chorus, no lyric. Now this is where things are starting to wind up. 30 seconds left of what? E, chorus. Na 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 na. How many times are they running that? We better track it, because we want to time it so that we end up at the very last part. All right, so it gave you those two little like juicy bits at the end that we could call H. There's like, what was it, three of them? Let's find out, because we're going to play the song again. Let's look at our map that we created, okay? I just want to shout out to a friend here. I'm going to say a name, so pardon that. But I do plan to post this, and I'm proud of it. But I only learned it because I worked with one person and one person only last year, Stephanie Larson. She was an old friend and colleague from my pro club days that did a private yoga teacher training. And she's a group fitness phenom. She's currently directing a new exciting community opening up. And she's going to be hiring a lot of graduates and a lot of professionals in the industry. And it's called True Fit. Oh, I better learn that if I'm going to throw the name around. But anyway, my buddy is a group fitness phenom, and she showed me how to map out a song. And I was like, honey, you've got a future teaching advanced teacher training workshops so teachers can learn this. So I'm appreciating the opportunity to share this info with you guys right now, because again, this is performance element. This is what can make your class just look so professional to your students that it would showcase to them just how much you cared to plan this out. You know, in our tradition, we have the second facet of the five facets of a brilliant class. It's an oath we take, which is what? Thou shalt not jack thy track. So we're going to also work on how you make sure your ab song starts when you need it to. But I digress. Let's get back into looking at the map. So again, thank you to Stephanie for this. So I don't know if you can see this, but it's, I wrote down A for the intro part. That's when the little clapping started. Now, you know, maybe you're getting yourself squared away, like moving from tree into the abs when it's doing the claps, or maybe you have them already set up and you're doing the claps, or you're maybe previewing what's happening while the claps are happening, but we would call A the intro. Okay, so it's going to have a unique activity unto itself that we won't see again, because there's no more intro after the intro. Similarly, that last little bit, those three little juicy bits at the end, we would call that the outro. And I think there was three of them. There might be two. We'll find out. So anyway, let me make sure I don't get ahead of us. So A, I wrote intro. That's the claps. B, I wrote beats. Because remember, things started to wind up after the intro part. So we're going to have a different activity for the beats. So we got to find out how many eight counts are they rolling. So like a bar of music is like eight counts. Two bars of music is 16 counts. So you can see how we're going to figure out how many reps we're going to do when we map this song out. Okay, C was the first verse. Remember the talking part where he started to tell the story of the song? I remember how he did that like twice, and then he kind of wound up into the transition. Okay, so there was this transition part, so we're calling that D. And then E is the chorus with the na-na-nas. Okay, it sounded like they ran that twice. So there's probably going to be an activity there we do a couple times. But again, you're labeling it A, B, C, D, and E because these are different activities in these pieces of the song. Okay, so the intro is going to have something special in A. The beats, we're going to do a specific activity. The C, the verse, we're going to be doing a specific activity. D, in the transition, we're going to do another specific activity. And then in the chorus, a specific activity. Now things are going to start to repeat because here we go. After the chorus, we have verse 2. That's where they're telling the story of the song. So we're going to go back to what we were doing in C and do it again. And we're going to do it twice. Then D happens again. That's that little transition. So we'll do that activity again. And then the chorus starts up again. So we'll do the chorus activity. And then there's the bridge. Remember that part where it started to be a little spoken word? Yeah, that bridge can be a rest, or it can be something different, or it can be something you're holding. That's often very fun. I think it's extra credit for a teacher to memorize what they're saying in the bridge, because maybe we would be holding a pose, maybe bridge pose. That's a nice countermeasure to doing isometric contractions to the ab. But my point is this, extra credit if you memorize the spoken word and kind of say that along with the song, like that's a good time. And then the chorus comes back. So we're going to do, but that, remember it's section G after that. It's the chorus without lyrics. So you have a choice to do something similar or different. And then we have the outro. Remember the juicy little part at the end, H, okay? So let's just back up for a second too. You're like, why are we doing this? This is yoga. We've been in this mind-body quest. We've been in this unite breath with movement quest. We've been in this free yourself from the stories of body image quest. Again, this is just a little surprise. This is some contrast. You know, this whole class you had music that didn't get in the way. This whole class you had music that wasn't lyrical. This whole time they've been practicing, they've been in the zone. And we haven't bugged them. We haven't said their names. We haven't, you know, corrected them in a punitive way. Like it's been, you know, just something they can get absorbed in. You know, we're not trying to pull them out of their practice. But this curveball we're throwing them out of nowhere at the 40-minute mark, that's showmanship. That's stagecraft. That's performance element. And people notice it. And they leave this class going, I don't know why I can't put my finger on it, but I love that class. I love that class. And people always are noticing that this, because it comes like a big burst and then it goes away. The song that's after this set is very blurry, no words, and it's pretty much going to be some half pigeon pose where they're in a real quiet introspective moment. And we do not speak of this again. This ab thing never happened. It's just this neat moment in time that kind of shook things up and then it went away. And we don't draw attention to it. Pro tip. Now we're going to do abs. No. You verb your body part and it just comes out of nowhere like a magic trick and then it leaves. Oh, I'm so glad we're done with abs. You guys are you tired now? Like, no, don't talk about it, right? It's part of your musical interpretation, part of your showmanship, part of your stagecraft is you're verbing your body part, saying the posture, then moving on. And it just becomes, in their whole recollection of the experience, part of the whole package, the whole experience. And they're going to go, wow, that's a really great class. And this is part of what's behind what's a really great class. So appreciate you listening. And I'm so pumped to teach you this. All right, so let's listen to the song again and look at the map, all right? So here we go. It's a 3-minute, 8-second song. All right, so what's the first part? A, this little clap. So what are we going to do during the claps? I don't know. I think we should clap. So we'll figure that one out. So we're in B, right? We've got the beats, right? I'm hearing the first 8 count. What's next? Second round. Okay. So that only ran it like 2 times. This is the verse, and he's on that first part. Second round, hear it? So we're gonna do 2 things there. Now the transition, this is D. So it's a little bit of a break. So if you're switching activities, this is where you could be telling them. And go, right? Because that transition part gave you time to load up the activity so that we could na 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 be doing something. Woo! Together. Move. Woo! Na 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 na. What's next? C. So whatever we were doing during the verse, we're doing it again. We're just back to that activity. Listen to the beat. Wait for it. What is it? It's that D thing, right? So whatever you got going for the chorus, you're gonna load it up right now in 3, 2, go. Yeah. Woo. Woo. Yeah. Na 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 na. Round two of whatever this is. Yeah. All right, now remember what's next? What was it? It's after the second chorus. It's the bridge. What's he saying? Head, shoulders, knees, toes. Look alive. It's time to go. Head, shoulders, knees, toes. Look alive. It's time to go. Head, shoulders, knees, and toes. Look alive. It's time to go. Ooh. Yeah. So remember, this is that chorus without lyrics. So, you know, I think we should keep it simple. We should go back to that same activity. Yeah. But now we get to be the singers. Ooh, gotta get up, gotta get it. Woo, gotta get up, gotta get it. Woo, na 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 na. Now here's, it repeats. Move, so this is awesome. We should track how many times it repeats. So that we can end it on time, so we can cue it. Because remember, you're not just counting reps. You're cueing for the transition. Yeah. Okay, that's a good time. I'm really in love with that song. And yeah, you're going to get it down. So this is our activity. You want to plan the activities that match the beats. So let's start to mix and match. Why don't we say that we get them into position in a boat pose for the clapping part? Because can you imagine the fun of everybody being in boat and doing the clap, 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 clap? We have enough time to transition then onto the floor for the beats part to do some basic crunch, okay? So I would do crunches, and we have two opportunities in section B. We heard whatever B was doing, they did it twice. So we're gonna have a couple sets of crunches there. Now, the verse that first comes up, remember, is a slow thing. It's running twice. So we could do something different. If we were doing basic crunches during the beats, I would say during the verse, since there's two parts, we could do two sides of a side oblique crunch. So let's keep it simple that section B is going to be just crunches. Section C is going to be side obliques, okay? And then there's the transition. So we have an opportunity to stop what we're doing and get into position so that during the chorus, we can do the fun stuff. Why don't we, in the load up position, do Pilates scissors legs so that we take full advantage of that slower pace and we get into the ready position so that when it goes to the chorus, we can do Pilates scissors repeaters, okay? And it's a really challenging activity. It's gonna be very fun and very cool. And when that chorus winds up, it goes to a verse. So remember how we were doing basic crunches. Remember we were doing side obliques for the basic, Remember we were doing side obliques for the verses because it has two parts to it and there's two sides. Since our legs are gonna be up doing Pilates scissors, during verse two, why don't we just crunch off to the side of the right legs for the first set and then crunch off to the side of the legs on the second set? So we're going to call that side obliques with Pilates scissors legs. And you'll see what this looks like in a second. Okay. Now, again, remember, after you're getting the first verse, it's the story stuff, and then the second side of the second verse of the story stuff, that it's that transition. And that's, again, where we can load up for the next activity. So let's say that that chorus opportunity after this next D section that we're on, instead of doing Pilates scissors for the chorus, let's go to bicycles for the chorus. And that's going to come in handy because, remember, there's a lot of chorus before the song is done, and it's a little bit easier to do the bicycles, but we can always offer that they straighten their legs if they like. So there's your all levels offering. Everyone can get into the bicycles, or they can do Pilates scissors, or if they're really getting tired, they can climb the rope. So you'll see what that looks like in a second. Because remember, we've got the head, shoulders, knees, and toes. Head, shoulders, knees, and toes. That bridge thing, we could stop what we're doing, and we got to take full advantage of that. I think it'd be really cool if during the bridge, we got back into the boat shape. So I'm thinking it, because I just think it'd be really fun for us all to have eye contact with each other while we're singing that part. So it's going to involve some sort of scissoring the legs while propped up on the elbows, okay? Scissoring the legs propped up on the elbows. And then it transitions us just back to the fun of the chorus to finish it off. And by then, everybody has their options figured out about if they're doing Pilates legs or bicycle legs or climb the rope legs, or they're just resting and singing, okay? And by the time we hear the H section where it's just the little sizzle at the end, you know, we're going to figure out how we're going to end it on that, on the last beat, okay? That really shows them that you cared enough to plan this out, okay? And it's only 3 minutes, 8 seconds, so we can do this. We can figure it out. Let's get into it, okay? All right, so phase one, play song. Phase two, pet cat. Phase three, rock out. Here we go. Now, remember, you had them in tree pose, okay, during your last song. So this is a good moment for us really quickly to talk about that pre-ab song, all right? I've given you a few suggestions. Let's imagine that you had for your pre-ab song the shortest song ever that you could have in your stash of music. Let me show you. Division by Moby is one of those really short songs that is great to put. Hey, Greg, Nemo wants out. Sorry, guys. So let's look at just, here's your phone. I'm assuming you're using Apple Music and iTunes. So when you're in a playlist and you're teaching your class and you are wishing to change the order of your songs in an effort to start your ab track on time, here's what you would do. When the people are in their child's pose before they take their water sip and then go back to child's pose, okay, right before section seven, this is where you can be planning out, like, okay, section seven is going to take about 3.5 minutes. So does that mean I'm going to have time for tree? And is that going to mean that I can finish at my tree before my abs start? So some of these songs that you would put in that are super short that could buy you another couple minutes, like I should have done in that power video we were watching, is this one. It's called Division by Moby. It's from the album Wait For Me Deluxe Edition. And it's only like a minute. It's like, what is it? It's 1 minute, 57 seconds. Okay. So you could be finishing up your tree with this song playing. There's your right side tree happening. Hands at heart. You extend your branches. You flow your branches. You look up for more challenge. You bring your eyes back to the horizon. You bring hands back to heart center. Second side. Shift your work to your right leg. Put your left foot above or below your knee. And bring your hands to your heart. Grow your branches. Relax your shoulders. Lift your eyes. You might even add a little back bend here. If you have not wobbled yet, consider blinking your eyes closed, even if for just one moment. Change. Inhale, circle sweep, upward salute. Exhale, forward fold. Malasana, walk your feet to mat width. Now, you want to burn up the rest of this song before you sit down to boat. And since this song's only a minute 57 seconds, this is a good 27 second moment to, you know, have them separate their feet and push their elbows into their inner thigh line, maybe pushing the inner thighs into the elbows to help loosen their lower back. And then you would sit them down. And the idea would be that when you sit them down is when that clapping part started. So the point that I am making to you here is when you're using Apple Music, when you're using iTunes in real time, like during your class, you want to have your songs in your playlist that you could scoot them around in real time as needed. So in this instance, I have you in child's pose while I'm getting my act together between section 6 and 7. You push edit in your playlist and you see those three little lines at the end of each song. That's what you can then use your thumb to move the songs around. Make sure while you're doing this, because you know you're probably also cueing your class, that you remember to hit done so that it saves the change. So in this instant, when we sat down, in those last couple moments of the Moby song, we know exactly what's coming up next. So this is where you would then take your left hand, have your seat, bring your knees together, and let's create boat. All right, basic crunch. Feet down, fingers behind your head, up, up, up. Keep your back flat. Keep your fingers behind your ears. Keep your chin up for 3, 2, 1. So now it's starting the verse. So what did we decide we're gonna do with the verse? We decided we were gonna do side obliques, okay? So let's back up a couple tips. So there we are. Exhale to execute. Uh-huh. It is time to put your knees to the side. Side obliques. It's up, 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 up. Second side. Put your knees over to the right. Side oblique. Crunch, crunch, up, up. Now here's the transition. Bring your knees to chest. Kick your legs up. Hold onto your right leg. Drop your left. All right, friends. Go, Pilates scissors. Woo, gotta get up, gotta get up. Woo, trade your legs. Drop your left, hold your right. Gotta get up, gotta get up. Woo, gotta get up, gotta get up. Woo, gotta get up, gotta get up. Woo, na 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 na. All right, so that was our chorus activity. So remember how we decided that we were going to then do side obliques for the second verse again. So let's back it up a tick. We're venturing into what we're doing on the section C again. So here we go. All right, we got them into position and we did, here we go. Pilates scissors for the chorus. Woo, gotta get up, we gotta get up. Woo, keep your chin off your chest. Na 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 na. Trade your right with your left. Trade your right with your left. Here we go. Last three, last two, last time. Side crunches to the side. So your fingers are behind your ears and we're crunching to the right. Because remember, here's the verse. Woo! Second side. There's his second little spiel. in the second verse. And so there you are, keeping your chin off your chest. Now here's your transition. Here's your transition. What did we decide? What did we decide we were going to do that next set? After we did those side obliques with the Pilates scissors legs, we were going to do just general bicycles. So let's back it up a couple ticks. Gotta get up, yes. So you're doing your Pilates scissors. Okay, this is that second verse. Yeah, so we're maybe you would side oblique it with fingers behind the ears or straight arms. Second side. Here you go. Remember, because it's the second part of the second verse. All right, last three, last two, last time. So he's in the transition moment. We're saying bicycles, guys, create 90 degrees, push away your knees, fingers behind your ears. Ready, set, go. Move, point your toes. Keep your old chin off your chest. Exhale to execute. Oh yeah, woo. Gotta get up, we gotta get up. Woo, keep your back flat. Keep your belly button pushed on down. Here we go. Three, two, now cross and reach. Remember? Remember? Head, shoulders, knees, toes. Look alive. It's time to go. We decided we're gonna do something where we can see each other, right? So let's figure out that little transition. Let's back it up a tick. So we're gonna kick it back two little ticks. Two little ticks. Woo! All right, so remember, we are bicycles. Bicycles. Finishing up. Oh, here we go. Now put your hands under your hips. Let's lower 60 degrees. Shoulders, knees, and toes. Let's meet everybody. Here we go. Head, shoulders, knees, toes. Look alive. It's time to go. Head, shoulders, knees, and toes. Look alive. Time to go. Woo. See? So now at this point, you're loaded up. Pilates scissors or bicycles. Let's go. Gotta get up, gotta get up. Woo! Almost there. And if you're getting tired, you can climb the rope, right? Something for everybody. Last part. Yes! Yes, so by now everyone's choosing their activity. They're either gonna do Pilates scissors, they're gonna do bicycles, or they're gonna do climb the rope. Gotta get up, gotta get up, gotta get up, gotta get up. All right, now let's do for the sizzle. Yeah, here we go. Last two. Last time. And stop. Yeah. All right, good. All right, cool. So now some good short songs that you can put in before your ab track, I see, is a request on the Facebook Messenger from Karina. Hello, lovey. And so let's do that. Here is Autumn Morning. It is 2:20. So I'm going to post this in your guys' group. This is a really good one that, again, you could be using this for tree, right? Imagine you're in tree, so this is the perfect song to put before your abs, right? Because it's not gonna rush your tree. And it's really easy to hear the changes in the song. Because listen to this part. Okay, now you have 90 seconds. So this is a good time for that second half of tree. Now this is halfway through the song. Okay, there's 1 minute left. So this is definitely where the song kind of picks up and gets kind of bouncy. So if by this time you had them folded forward and you separated their feet, you had them sitting down in their squat, you only have, you know, less than a minute. So this is a great time to just, hey, we're not talking about abs. We're not saying this is what's coming up. We just have them in this nice low squat as we're burning up the rest of the song. As we're burning up the rest of this song, because we don't jack the track, we don't fast forward, we have a good 30 seconds that we could then sit them down on their buns, and we could bring the knees to the chest, and we could set up with just a gentle Navasana, like, you know, hey, nothing to see here. And it kind of kicks up for the last 20 seconds. So this is a beautiful, sweet little tune that you could then lower, three, to the floor, so that you can start your ab track, okay? So there's one. Let's give you some more short songs that you can use. I like to call them warning songs, you know, because I want to know when my ab track is coming up. Here's a wonderful one. Vladimir's Blues, that's what was playing at the beginning of the power video we were looking at. It's only 1 minute, 18 seconds. And so that is probably my very favorite of the shortest, short songs that I like to put in my playlist. And again, guys, here's where we're putting these little short songs. I put them at the bottom of the stack in the playlist so that when I hit edit and I need to scoot things around, I know where it is. I don't have to search for it in my library. Does that make sense? I don't have to come up with it out of the blue, like, crap, what playlist was that one song on? I want to put it in here real quick before my abs start. And I say this because, trust me, I've been that person who all of a sudden was like caught off guard. So whenever I make a 60-minute playlist, I put at least three of those less than 2-minute warning filler songs so that I start when my abs start, right? And I know why Karina asked this, because remember, she's that really cool song she's going to use. And yeah, you want to land that exactly on the first beat. Okay, here's another wonderful short filler song that has lyrics, but they're really pretty lyrics. And you can use this because it's 1 minute, 39 seconds. So you're not talking while the artist is talking, and you don't need to because it's a tree. Where I'll end up, well, I think only God really knows. I've sat upon the setting sun, but never, 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 I never wanted water once, but never, never, never. Listen to my words, but they fall far below. I let my music take me where my heart wants to go. I swam upon the devil's lake, but never, 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 I'll never make the same mistake. Never, never, never. And then boom, drop it, right? Okay, so let's see. I feel like I've given you quite a few to choose from, so I hope that meets your needs. The Wind, Vladimir's Blues, Autumn Morning, Bramrar by Led Zeppelin. Extra credit for using Led Zeppelin in a playlist. You know, wake me up out of a coma with that song, should the need arise. Okay, so yeah, just that last little bit of advice. Let's just review that, and then we're hanging this lecture up, guys. We're done. The idea here is that when you make a playlist, so here's a playlist. Here is a playlist. The playlist. Right there. It's downloaded on your phone. So that upper corner, you see where it says edit, see where the green circle says add music, point and click there. And then that's where you can grab a song and put it in to your playlist. And that's where you could then put it at the bottom of the pack. Oh, Intro by the XX would be another good one too, guys. Because it in itself is a good app song, just in and of itself. honestly, you can put this song anywhere in the class where you want to get the job done, okay? Here's another couple of the songs that came up in our work this weekend. That land, repair, and refuel song. I know that we talked about this one before. It's just a 3-minute song, and it gets the job done no matter what the job is. It starts off with this nice, sizzly, spacious part. It's only 3 minutes, 8 seconds long. Remember this deal there? Yeah, that could be an ab song. That, heck, it could be a tree song. I mean, this kind of music completely captures what you're looking for in yoga, because it could function for a tree song or an ab song. So while you're learning, guys, you want to keep things massively super duper simple. And the simpler, the easier is that stuff that you don't have to be married to the exact beginning, middle, and end, like we were showcasing with Saint Hotel Move. You know what I'm saying? So if this whole activity flusters you and freaks you out, you know, you'll want to choose more along the lines of stuff like this: land, repair, and refuel. So I put that in your thread too. All right. Well, thank you for this time to share with you about choreographing abs, why, when, where in the sequencing, for whom, and at what cost. You know, don't be stuck up. Don't be one of those yoga teachers. Oh, it's exercise. You know, we're here to do the mind-body thing. Dang it, this is third chakra stuff. And so if you're checking people in a class and they're a little dejected for whatever life's thrown at them, help them bolster it up. You know, if I got people checking into a 6 a.m. class and they got like a public speaking engagement at work that day they're worried about, fucking we rock the abs because we want to send them off with all that chutzpah, right? Similarly, if it's high noon and all my pittas are hell out of balance, just crazy, chatty, and mad, and picky, and traffic was bad, and they're feeling raw, I tone it a little down with the abs. You know, we do just a little bit. Like, we want to meet their needs, but we don't want to blow them up. Remember, pitta out of balance, that lives in your core. That lives in your third chakra. That is your inner fire. So if you yourself as a pitta are out of balance, skip your abs. Do supported bridge or twists. Those are the two remedies to get the pitta cooled down. So that's your opposite spectrum. So your counter poses. So as you know, in the sequence, we'll hit the hips and the bridge stuff. So anyway, getting ahead of myself. And I'm just, again, thanking you for your attention to this information. And I hope this has helped you to create fun classes that add a little bit of the performance element. All right. Okay. It's lunchtime. And so let's take a break, guys. Thanks. Bye.